Good morning and welcome to Arkansas Association of Energy Engineers three-part webinar series, Understanding the Science Behind Mitigating the Transmission of COVID-19. This is Angela Kulai, Director of Education for AAEE, and I'm glad you're able to join us. We will start the webinar in a couple of minutes to allow everyone time to log in. Thank you. Dustin, I think I'll go ahead and get started.
Sounds good.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us for our first course in the Understanding Science Behind Mitigating the Transmission of COVID-19 webinar series. Today's course will be on understanding the transmission paths of infectious pathogens. In today's webinar, we will hear approximately 90 minutes of presentation material. Each of you are muted automatically, but we do want to hear from you. We want to hear your input and your experiences during the session. Take a look at the Zoom bar on your screen. You will see a Q&A button. Please use this for specific questions for all participants. We'll be watching for these questions throughout the presentation and encourage you to ask for further information or clarification during the presentation as needed. You also have a chat button. You can click on that and type in your thoughts and responses as we go through the webinar. All chat box feedback will be seen by the panelists only. This feature does not publish to the whole audience. Finally, we will be utilizing the polling feature through the presentation to gauge your level of understanding. Your answers only come to the panelists, so please do participate. You will not see this option on your Zoom bar. The panelists will launch the polls at the appropriate time. We will have 2 5-minute breaks throughout the course. And following the course, you will receive an email requesting course feedback. Please do complete that survey as it is required for our grant reporting.
All right.
With that being said, I'll introduce our instructor, Dustin Schaefer. Dustin received his Bachelor of Science in Architectural Engineering and a Postgraduate Studies from Kansas State University. He holds a professional engineering license and is LEED AP BB plus C accredited. Dustin is known as one of the masterminds behind the core foundations of Henderson's business, quality, sustainability, and company operations. Dustin started at Henderson as Director of Sustainable Services with the goal of integrating sustainable design into projects and also teams. Since then, he implemented and improved services such as sustainable master planning, energy benchmarking, and energy modeling procedures and training. Now a senior vice president and director of engineering, Dustin runs the internal group at Henderson dedicated solely to quality, setting Henderson apart from the competition. Working with Dustin on this project, it is clear Dustin is not only passionate about executing his job with quality and excellence, he also pushes for valuable relationships along the way. Dustin, Thank you for being here today to present to us on this timely subject. I will go ahead and pass to you.
Thanks, Angela. That was a nice introduction. Those make me uncomfortable 100% of the time as an engineer listening to somebody talk about me. So thank you for that, though. That was nice. So this presentation today is about the science behind the transmission of COVID. I'm going to make an effort to explain this in a way that is understandable, but also in depth. So we have a lot of time, which is nice. We have good time to go through this material, and we're going to spend it today on the transmission paths. Before I do that, I do need to thank our sponsors for this. This was possible because of a nice grant that we were able to utilize to put this material together. It is in-depth material that I made specifically for you today. So I hope that it's valuable. Thank you to our sponsors that really did make this possible. So an interesting thing before we get into the material that I realized is that most of the science is not very understandable. And I think that that's not necessarily on purpose, but it's written for scientists. So there's this overlap. There's scientists doing their job, virologists and epidemiologists doing their job, producing things in a way that other virologists and epidemiologists can utilize to build off of. But it's not for the average person to consume. So I think there's this little bit of overlap between this detailed science and what we do as engineers and building systems experts, where I can explain this in a way that is a little more relatable. So that's what I'm going to try to do today. I am an engineer. I'm not a virologist. I'm not a scientist, but I think this stuff is understandable. There's some common language in there if you look for it. So over the course of these next three sessions, we're going to not only look at how it's transmitted and the science behind the transmission paths, but how you mitigate it in the air. And then really interestingly enough, I think at the end, we're going to look at estimating the risk of transmission using probabilities and statistical analysis and some equations that have been around for a long time to do mathematical models of transmission and take what we know about how the disease is transmitted, how the virus is transmitted, what we know about airborne mitigation, and then put those together with these mathematical models and really estimate the risk. Today, what we're going to focus on are the transmission paths. At the end of this, this is always kind of a throwaway slide that people gloss over in these because it's a requirement, but these are real things. Like, I really do believe at the end of this session today, I want you to understand the three transmission paths in a building. We're going to go in depth in those. This sounds very general here to throw in, but explain the difference between a logarithmic scale and a traditional scale. This science is on the surface confusing because of that. That's the one thing that jumped out to me as I was studying these. So I'm going to talk about that a little bit. And then I want you to be able to interpret the science behind the survivability of this virus on surfaces and in the air, and then talk about ways to break the transmission paths. Again, this is not a throwaway thing. These are difficult topics that we all intuitively think we understand, but when you get into it, there's a lot more depth to it than the media puts out there. All right, another thing, I've got some like cursory, just foundational slides to go through in the beginning. Another one we ought to talk about that confused my team a little bit as we look through this is terms are used interchangeably that aren't interchangeable. So for example, a coronavirus is a category of viruses of which there are many. SARS has multiple variants. SARS-CoV-1 was what was known as SARS. You heard about that maybe 10 years ago. SARS was a thing. That was a coronavirus, a particular strain of coronavirus that caused a particular disease called SARS. Now we are looking at SARS-CoV-2, which is a particular strain of coronavirus that causes COVID-19. Those are different things. A lot of the science generally applies to coronavirus, which is probably valid. Some of it applies specifically to this SARS-CoV-2 coronavirus, which causes COVID-19. So I will probably slip up, use these terms interchangeably as I go through the presentation, but just know what I'm talking about. I will try to be specific if I'm talking about general coronavirus, SARS-CoV-2, or COVID-1, or MERS. All right. Last foundational thing here. This was a really, really good article in the MIT Technology Review this last month. And the article is called "Why You Don't Really Know What You Know." And it's about how each of us thinks we know things that when you get right down to it, we only know them, but we don't understand them. And I know that's a little philosophical, but what I was trying to do with COVID was actually build some understanding, not just rely totally on the fact that someone told me this thing is true, so I assume it as knowledge. Examples of that, in the article it talked about, if you ask people, do you know how a zipper works, everybody says, yeah, sure, I know how a zipper works. But if you say, well, how does a zipper work? You know, what happens when you move the pull up and down the zipper? What's happening inside there? People realize they don't really know how a zipper works. They just know that it works. So what I was trying to do here is get behind that first level and help us dive down to, well, if we know something, why do we know that? And what is the science behind that known truth? So as I said, I'm not a virologist. It was obvious to me as I go through this and try to explain it. There are things I don't know as well as I want to, but I'm trying. So this proved it once again to me that if you really want to know something, you try to teach it to other people. That's what I'm doing here. I answered a lot of my own questions as I went through this. I hope that I can do the same for you. So please do put questions in the chat if you have them, and we'll do our best to get to those, because what I want to do is build some common knowledge that we can all work from as we go to these next sessions and as we do our jobs and help our clients. All right, so what I'm going to do as I go through each one of these sections is talk about a transmission path, talk about some scientific claims that we could make, and then go through the science and evidence behind that claim. So you'll see a pattern emerging as we go through these. I'm trying to not ever make an unfounded claim. I'm trying to say this is a thing I think to be true, and then here's the science behind it. So we're going to spend a minute on this page here. This is called a cause map. This is something that a friend and I put together back in March to just kind of lay out the three main transmission paths of viruses in buildings, of the spread of infection in buildings, and then walk backwards to potential solutions. So this is not an intuitive document the first time you see it. I'd like to spend a minute and walk through it, because I do use this as a framework to go through the rest of the presentation. So when you look at this diagram, it's a left to right read, right? So you look over here at the left and you say, well, I've got a risk of viral infection. And then as you move to the right, it breaks down causes. So if the viral infection, the risk of viral infection is what you're trying to break, you have three different causes that all roll off to the right here with subsequent sub-causes. I just want to go through those in general, and then we'll spend the rest of the time going through them in specific. So there are three different main paths of transmission in the built environment. There's surface transmission, which is sometimes called fomite transmission. There is droplet transmission, and there's airborne transmission. Each of these is distinct. There are different causes for each of these. Just as an example, to show you how the chart works, if you take the droplet transmission path and go one step to the right, it shows you that in order for a person to have direct contact with infectable respiratory droplets, somebody has to sneeze or cough those large droplets into the space, and you have to be an uninfected person within a 10-foot radius of that person. Both of those things have to be true for you to contact that large droplet. So to break that cause, you could wear a mask, which impedes the flow of those large particles when you sneeze, or you could be farther away from a person. You do that with all of these, right? There's droplet transmission, surface, and airborne. First, we're gonna go through droplet transmission and the science behind that, and then we'll go through the subsequent ones. So looking at this droplet transmission section first, Kind of the question I had is, well, what is a large droplet? So if we're talking about sneezes expelling large droplets being different than breathing expelling small droplets, what is large versus small? And this question of scale becomes important pretty quickly. Intuitively, we know things we can see, like the difference between the length of a guitar and the length of a pencil point is intuitive. That's 1 centimeter versus 1 millimeter. But when you get smaller than that, it's less intuitive. So if I told somebody a micrometer, a micrometer, which is to the left here of millimeter, that's about the size of a bacteria, which we have to imagine. You can't see with your eyes the size of a bacteria. If you go to a nanometer, that's about the size of a DNA strand, which is obviously extremely small. So scientists throw around terms like nanometer and micrometer pretty easily, pretty commonly, but they're not intuitive. I thought this was helpful to lay out on the scale and then overlay large or small droplet on top of that. So 5 micrometers, which is called 5 microns, those words are interchangeable. Below that are small droplets, above that are large droplets. So does that mean that something that is 5.1 or 4.9 is totally different? No, but it does mean that generally we talk about large droplets being 5 microns or bigger, small droplets being 5 microns or smaller. And those are all really, really small. So when you think about somebody sneezing and the really massive droplets coming out, it's quite a bit smaller than that, still being called a large droplet. All right. So let's look at some published scientific evidence around large droplets. This is a claim I would make, that the 6-foot distance rule will reduce but not eliminate the risk of large droplet contact. So CDC and others have said, let's stay 6 feet apart from each other. It's been treated like gospel, right? Like literal tape measures put on the ground in our buildings saying stay 6 feet apart. It is good guidance. And I do think it will reduce the risk of large droplet contact. Pay attention to that, because when we come back through the aerosol section, those are different things. So this rule, the 6-foot rule, is designed to reduce large droplet contact. And I do think it does that. There's a study, a really gross study, where they had people sneeze in front of a laser backlight, and they measured the distance that particles came from their sneezes out of their mouths at different droplet sizes. In general, this was a great graphic that came from the Manual of Physical Distancing. In general, you can see here to the left, big droplets do tend to fall from 3 to 6 feet from the person. Some of them fall 6.1 feet, some might fall 7, a lot fall below 3. That's where that 6-foot guidance came from. There is science to back up the fact that most large droplets fall within 6 feet. When we get to the aerosol section, you'll see that those are two different things. Aerosols are small droplets. Large droplets fall quickly, aerosols don't. So this rule, the social distancing rule, combats one of the 3 transmission paths we talked about. And I think it's interesting, it's really treated like a solution to everything, that if you're socially distant, you're fine. It's really to attack that one path, the large droplet path. It's kind of odd, just being humans with each other, it's odd to not be able to see on these kinds of things, on these webinars, the people you're presenting to. So I'm counting on you submitting questions if you have them. Otherwise, it's just me talking. All right, so talking about large droplets, one thing I learned in the research, and we're going to go through a really specific study here after this slide, masks are highly effective at large droplet, at stopping large droplet transmission. There's a study to show that at all particle sizes, pretty much anything acting as a mask is between 20 and 80% effective in capturing all particle sizes. But what's interesting is almost everything practical that people are using for masks, masks approaches 100% effectiveness at large particles. So before you get too excited about that, Remember, I'm making a distinction here in this conversation about large and small. These are the large ones. Masks are very, very effective at capturing those large particles. And there is science behind that. So digging into it a little bit for us engineers, here's the test rig that was used. This was the American Chemical Society that published this. This study has been referenced a lot. If you read articles that talk about the effectiveness of masks, a lot of them reference this particular study. And there's a correction to this study that has come out that if you are an average human and you see that and you see correction, you think, well, the initial one must have been wrong. In my understanding, I don't think the initial study was wrong. I think they clarified some things in the correction that helped make more sense, but it didn't say that our science was bad. And I'll talk about those. So look at this testing rig, it's interesting. They take mask material, put it over a PVC pipe, generate particles on one side that's pressurized, draw it across the material, measure the particles upstream and downstream of the material on the way to the exhaust. So what they're doing is testing the ability of that material pulled tightly across the PVC pipe to stop particles based on different size ranges. And they pull those in and they scan them at different size ranges upstream and downstream. To simulate leakage, they did these holes in the side of the PVC pipe downstream of the fabric. One of the things they put in their correction was that they feel like that overestimated the amount of leakage that a person might get in a mask. And I'll show you in the results, it was a pretty dramatic impact when they incorporated leakage into these. I think there are some conclusions we can draw from that. But what I want to do is just lay out the science and then show you, and you can draw your conclusions from what you think it means. So anyway, this was the test rig. The results of that take a little bit to talk through here. So this particle size across the bottom on the x-axis, they published that in nanometers. Really, really small, right? Like 1 nanometer, this 10 to the first down there, we're talking the size of DNA. That's very small. If you go to 10 to the third, that's 1 micron. So 5 microns and above is what we're talking about for large droplets. You can see that's where they quit testing. Most of these common materials up here at the top, this cotton 600 threads per inch is, imagine a sheet, you know, sheets. This cotton 80 is really batting. So think of the stuffing in a quilt or in a stuffed animal, that's what that is. That's obviously not a great mask, but what they were doing is looking at that for electrostatic filter on really ultra fine particles. They tried to pick some materials that they thought would have electrostatic attraction at really small particles, even though they're obviously terrible filters for large particles. And cotton batting to me would certainly fall into that category. But if you look at this, paying special attention to that 1 micron to 5 micron or 5 microns and above, those are the particles that are coming out during speech or sneezing. As we approach this 5 micron line, just plain old cotton was approaching 100% effectiveness at stopping those big particles. So when you get down here, chiffon and flannel and silk, they're worse, right? These are worse materials than just plain old cotton, but they all start to tick up to their highest effectiveness here at these ultra big particles. So in the aerosol section, we'll talk about the small particle size. I thought it was interesting, these homemade cotton masks can approach 100% effectiveness. Keep in mind, completely put over the face of this pipe, so with no leakage. So when you look at leakage, it gets interesting. So these were combination masks that they studied against an N95. All of them did really well up here in this no leakage category. When you look down here and you compare cotton silk combination without a gap to one with a gap, or a surgical mask, even an N95 mask without a gap or with a gap, dramatic difference, right? So they came back and said, hey, we think there is a really significant difference, but the holes we drilled were too big. they created too much of an easy path for air, and we overstated the amount of leakage. I think they're probably right. But I do think that it's worth noting that if your mask doesn't fit properly, as you go, especially into smaller particle sizes, it's not going to work as well, right? That's obvious and intuitive. But what this tells me is if you can get a mask that fits you pretty well, you can approach 100% effectiveness at these large droplets. And we'll walk that claim down a little bit for the small droplets, but keep in mind this 5 microns and above. So for up here on the top chart, 5 microns and above, we're approaching 100% effectiveness backed by a scientific study here. I think that's a claim we could make. All right, interesting thing I thought. This study is referenced, like when I Googled this study, one of the things that came up was this mask you can buy on Etsy. The reference is that study. And it says, well, here's a combination 600 thread count cotton plus chiffon face mask that you can buy. And it references this study as a reason that you should buy that particular face mask. So this is capitalism at work. This is good, right? These are scientifically backed masks. This mask, if it fit you properly, could be pretty effective at stopping large particles. All right, so we talked a little bit about how these droplets fall and the distance that they take to fall. And we talked about stopping them with masks. I think it's important to talk about the relative importance of each of these things. And it really depends on what you're doing. So I thought this chart was very good. This was also in the study, the first one I showed you with the gross sneezing picture. They made this point that whether or not you're wearing a mask, whether or not you're around the person for a long time, and whether you're indoors or outdoors and what you're doing, all weigh into the risk. And that as you move from less risky to more risky, the importance of social distancing, the importance of maintaining that 6 feet becomes a bigger deal. So if you're being silent, sitting outdoors in a well-ventilated area, sitting around a campfire, and you're wearing a face mask, you have very low risk. You could realistically be sitting right by somebody in that situation and not experience very much risk of contracting COVID. Conversely, if you're singing or shouting with no face covering in a poorly ventilated space, the more distance you can maintain, the better. And again, that's very intuitive, but I think that for simplicity's sake, these rules get applied uniformly, and that's not necessarily a scientific way to do it. So in your mind, as you're thinking about going through life or consulting with clients, I think it's important to say that the situation and the activity and whether or not you have masks really does impact whether or not social distancing is a key strategy. I thought this was a great graphic. I'm leaving it up here for a minute so people can kind of look at the different categories. This is posted, this presentation will be posted. So if you wanna look at it later, that will be available. I thought this graphic was a hilarious graphic that I thought of as I looked at the other one, but it also does make a point that things that incur COVID risk aren't always risky behavior. So if you go from left to right across the top, that's COVID risk. If you go from top to bottom, that's just regular risk. So singing in church is something that is usually in a poorly ventilated area packed in there, and loud singing expels a lot of particles. That's high COVID risk. Bungee jumping while doing sword tricks is an individual event outside. You're probably not going to contract COVID from anybody, but it's highly dangerous and highly risky. These are jokes, but I thought it was a really interesting way to look at things, is that you have to separate. Yeah, this was an XKCD graphic. Somebody put in the questions. It's a good site. My daughter loves it and does little sketches all the time in that style, but I thought this was good. And I thought it was hilarious that the highest risk COVID and highest risk thing you can do is win a test tube eating contest at a COVID testing lab. So none of that. Don't do that. All right. So examples in the built environment, this putting on the lens of large droplet transmission and looking at the areas where that's hardest to deal with, secured entry is a category that's really difficult to deal with. So anywhere where you take lots of people and queue them up and tell them to wait to get into a space that they want to get into, they get really mushed together. People want to be close because they want to be in that space. So this happens to be at a venue. It could be outside of a store, could be secured entry at a warehouse. people want to get in a bunch of time clock. That's just a difficult situation where people tend to congregate. So this is something that as building scientists and as engineers, we work on all the time. How do you deal with that? That's a tough situation. Venue seating. We work with a lot of professional sports leagues, a lot of auditoriums, a lot of venues. It's a difficult thing because you want to sell seats and you want density in your spectators and your audience. And people tend to not want to wear masks once they're in there. They either eat popcorn for 3 hours or they're shouting, the mask gets in the way. It's just a difficult situation, and social distancing does help in this situation. And I'll go through why that's important, especially when we get into the aerosol section. But this is tough. This is a problem that a lot of professional sports leagues are struggling with right now. Is how do you maintain that distance, knowing that people aren't going to be great at wearing their masks, and keep people safe in your venue? Classrooms. Kids are notoriously difficult to manage consistently. And these are small spaces and they're high density spaces. So especially K through five, K through six, elementary school, that's tricky. It's very difficult to solve. And when we get to the solutions and looking at the risk mitigation with different solutions, we'll specifically look at this case because it is tricky. And mask compliance is not great on a seven-year-old. You know, there are just all kinds of things that make this a hard situation. Then the last one in here, second to last one, is public transportation. Just lots of people. This could be a train station, an airport, bus station, riding a bus. All these things bring people together from lots of different places for a long time in a small space. And again, it's difficult to maintain separation when the whole business model is set around density and packing people in there. That's a tough situation. That really, the only good solution to that is mask wearing and maintaining distance when you can for this large droplet path. And then the last one, the shared offices. Again, it's just a density business model. So not to call anybody out, but like co-working spaces and other things that are built on having desks close together for a long period of time, a mask wearing at your desk becomes an important thing. And that's not something that people are typically advocating for in an office space. They might say, when you get to your desk, it's okay if you take your mask off. And I think I feel a little differently about that after reading some of this science. All right. 30 minutes in, we got a quiz time, a short quiz on the droplet section. This was one of the shorter sections, and then we'll take a 5 minute break, 7 minute break. We're gonna look at how long it takes people to answer these questions here. So answer these questions. It is now 9:33. I'm gonna come back at 9:38 and we'll pick up the next section, the surface section. So thank you for your attention so far. I appreciate it. Also, I was reminded to remind you that you must answer these questions to receive credit for attending. So please do that. There's only 3 questions per section. They go pretty fast. Also, speaking of being humans, I moved the slide on log reduction to the next section. So there's a question in here that you might not be able to answer. I'll just spoiler alert, one log reduction is a 90% reduction. So hopefully that helps you out. Yeah, I think also a question on UV. We'll talk about these here because I did not talk about that yet. I think these questions, there's 9 of them on the whole thing. 3 of them got put to the front. And I didn't necessarily cover all the material in this order. So we're all going to do these together because that's how it works. It's an open book test. So which bands of UV have been proven to inactivate SARS? These questions should have shown up. They should have popped up on your screen. If not, there's a couple people asking about that. Maybe Amanda, you can look into that. We will send this out afterwards, I think. Don't get too upset about not getting credit if this doesn't work. But the UV question, it's really UVB and UVC that are most effective. So that would be what option 5 there. I'm not looking to trick anybody with these questions. So that was 5 minutes, but I feel like I owe you a little more time based on our trickiness with the questions. I apologize for that. All right. So apologize for the question weirdness. Let's just talk about these. I'll just answer them real quick here. So one log reduction is a 90% reduction. Amanda is putting some things in the chat about the questions. You'll get it after the fact and get a chance to answer these. But one log reduction is a 90% reduction. All of the above are ways that COVID is spread. And UV, the most effective bands are B and C. And some of these things I'll go over in the coming sections. So get excited. I'm going to close the questions. And we'll keep rolling. So I would say in the survey of me for this presentation, it is a known thing that those questions didn't work well. So feel free to put comments in there about that, but that one I'm aware of. All right, so transmission paths, we talked about large droplets, which I started with that because it's really kind of the most obvious, and that's what the guidance came out around first, is that diseases are spread, viruses are spread by large droplet transmission. That is a known thing. Some of these other ones are where you kind of have to use your intuition. You have to read science and then say, well, because this happened, I think an infection could happen. So this is the first one. Fomite is where we're going to do that first. And then aerosol, you really have to say, well, there's some logic train I have to go through to say that it is airborne, because you can't test, you can't put people in the room and say, did this person get it, when I've, you know, set up a condition where they touched a surface that somebody sneezed on. You can't do that. That's unethical, right? So some of these things you have to start to say, well, I assume this could happen if this other thing happened. So back to this cause map. We looked at droplets first. Now we're going to look at the surface transmission area. And this this one requires a little bit more going through on the cause map. So in order to have a surface transmission, infectable virus on your hand has to contact your face. So separate this from large droplets being breathed in, or small aerosol droplets. Like, you touch something that has a sufficient quantity of virus on it, you touch your face. So if you go left to right, you can see there's this hand touches. You have to touch a contaminated surface, and it has to be contaminated with infectable virus, and your hand has to touch it. You go left to right again. The infectable virus, in order to be transferred to a surface for you to touch it, the virus has to be transferred to that surface by an infected person, or an infected person has to shed large droplets and they fall onto that surface. And then if you take this bottom path here, the virus also, there's an and, the virus has to be able to survive on that surface. So somebody has to put it there, and it has to be able to survive there for the amount of time it takes for you to touch that surface. So there are all these solutions that we start to lay onto those things. And what we're going to go through in this section is the science behind why those are the causes, and then a little bit of the science behind the solutions. All right, so here's the, you know, spoiler alert on scales, but I thought this was important to talk about scales, because log scales are not intuitive, but they're useful in science and they get used a lot. So a log scale, or a log reduction, is a tenfold reduction. So to go from log 2 to log 1 is a tenfold reduction, a 90% reduction. That's a huge deal, a huge reduction. In terms of gross numbers, that's a lot bigger deal than to go the next log down, right? If you go from 100 to 10, that's a lot bigger than from 10 to 1 in terms of gross number. So when you talk about log scales, the most obvious one, the most familiar one, is the earthquake magnitude scale. Sometimes people call it the Richter scale, but it's really the earthquake magnitude scale. Each number you increase represents a tenfold increase. So to go from 7 to 8 is 10 times as powerful. That's a log scale. That's not something that's intuitive to most people. So if you look at that on a graph, you look at this on the left, you could go from, you know, 1 × 10⁶, 1 × 10⁵, that's a 1 log reduction. If you graph that, the lower left corner here, if you graph that, it looks pretty linear, right? This thing is linearly reducing at the same rate across all these different logs, log 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. A 90% reduction happens in that first 1 log reduction. If you graph that on a standard scale, like on the right, it looks really different. A 90% reduction looks like a 90% reduction in height of the scale, and you immediately recognize that as a lot. You don't on the log scale. So as we go through some of this science, and you'll see things that start at a 7 log or 8 log concentration, to go through 1 log reduction is a 90% reduction. Keep that in your head, because as engineers, if you're looking at things pragmatically, 90% reduction is a lot of the way there, right? So if you're talking about mitigating risk, maybe you don't need a 6 or 7 log reduction in a building scale. You might in a hospital or in an operating room, that little bit could make a difference. But in a classroom where you're trying to apply solutions and measure their impact, I think you need to be able to understand this pragmatically. And this was key for me. All right, so knowing that, let's look at some scientific evidence around surface transmission. So I think this is true. I think that the virus that causes COVID-19 can survive for days on non-porous surfaces if you deposit it in a large enough concentration and you keep it under the right temperature and humidity conditions. So if I'm writing an article that I want to get a lot of clicks, I would say this virus can live on your iPhone for 28 days. That's true. If you put a ton of it on there and you keep it in the dark in 50 degrees and perfect humidity, right? That's true, but that's not practically what's happening. So if you look at the science behind this, it's not obvious when you look at this test. This is the test that gets referenced a lot. This was in the New England Journal of Medicine. Great science, great test. What they did was test COVID-1 and COVID-2 over time on different surfaces and measure those concentrations. And you can see they started with about a 3 log concentration, between 3 and 4 log concentration, measured it over time. But this still isn't obvious what's happening here. So there are some things I want to talk about and then come back to this same chart and put some explanation on top of it and try to go from this being just information to knowledge. So hold on, hold this thought. So another article came out right after that one that said, I think that's overstated because I think that most studies that we're looking at start with huge samples, 10 to the third, sixth, seventh, really high concentrations of virus, and an actual person coughs out 20 to 100 particles per cough, not 1,000 or 10 million. So that's kind of a foundational thing. Look at the scale. And then I think it's important to say, well, what does it take to get a 1 log reduction in viable virus? And you can draw conclusions even from this study about that, right? So if we look at a 1 log reduction, this green bar, that at least gives you some context. And now we're thinking about a 90% reduction in viral concentration, not a 99.999, which would be a 5 log reduction. Again, very important in hospitals, less important on your iPhone. You're looking for, and when do I get most of the risk out of the way so I can make decisions about managing most of my risk? So look at this 1 log reduction, and then we draw a line down from that. On copper surfaces, you get a 1 log reduction in about a minute. So that's good, right? On stainless steel, I'm sorry, in about an hour. On stainless steel, it's about 8 hours. And on plastic, it's somewhere between 8 and 24 hours, depending on how you interpret the error bands. But it's not 8 days or 28 days, right? There's a time frame to these things. And that when we go onto the next slides and we look at how this, just the time factor, interacts with some of the other factors, I do think it's arguable that the surface risk, the surface transfer vector, is probably the lowest risk vector. And at the very least, it's the easiest to mitigate. So just have this in your mind, right? Like cardboard, doing nothing else, not having it in the sun, not wiping it down, in 8 hours, 90% of the viral load dies off. I think that's an important fact. So I just thought I'd check too, like we talk about wiping things down. Does that work or does that just make us feel better? There is science to show that that works. The EPA published a list of effective cleaners and basically it's everything on COVID. So alcohol, hydrogen peroxide, bleach, citric acid, lots of other things, lots of chemical compositions, Lysol, all those things work and have almost total kill, like almost 5 log reduction in under a minute. They're highly effective. There's also another study, National Center for Biotechnology Information, that went through specifically with 0.1% sodium hypochloride, which is bleach, and 62 to 71% ethanol. Again, they had 1 log reduction at least in 1 minute exposure time. So I feel really good in saying these things work. Intuitively, I think we knew that bleach works, but it's good to find that there is science behind that and standard surface cleaning agents do work. So even on a porous surface, if you know you have to touch it right after somebody sneezed on it, if you could get total coverage and a disinfecting agent, you can, again, get a one log reduction pretty quickly with these, with bleach or specifically ethanol. All right, this was one I thought was really interesting. Simulated sunlight. There's a study to study simulated sunlight on a petri dish with COVID-2 virus in it, and it was really effective. So UVB rapidly inactivated the virus. And so let's look a little bit at that study, because this, I think, was also an example of something not intuitive. So you look at this and you're like, okay, goes from something to nothing in some amount of time, right? And they drew this linear regression. You can see it's going down on three of these, not on one of them. The only one that's labeled was darkness on the lower right. But what I didn't know is, what is 1.6 watts per meter squared of UVB? What's 0.7? Is that a lot? You know, is that 10 times the amount the sun puts out? Is it 1/10? Which of these is a sunny day, which is a cloudy day? So I went and did some research on this. And just to explain it, I think we know this too, but light comes from the sun in lots of different wavelengths. And some of it is short and some of it's long. So you go from short here on the left to long on the right. And there are some bands outside of this. There's X-ray and radio and other things. But if we're talking about UV and visible light and infrared, they move from short to long, from left to right here. UVC is the shortest. And then UVB and UVA, visible light and infrared. C is filtered out by the ozone layer and is not naturally occurring on the surface of the earth. B and A do make it through. That's what causes skin cancer and tanning from the sun. And then visible light is obvious, and infrared light is a whole different thing. This study looked at UVB. And so I had the question, how much UVB irradiance actually falls on the earth? So I went and found a different study that said measured total irradiance of diffuse and direct solar radiation by wavelength. And then I went through and said, well, UVB ends at 315. So let's add up all the area under this curve. And I'm gonna be honest, I didn't do calculus. I just made it a triangle. And so this is approximately the area under this curve, because calculus has been a while. And when I added that up, even with my rough method, I came up with 1.5 watts per meter squared of total irradiance falling on an average day from diffuse and direct solar radiation of UVB. So now if we go back to this, like 1.5 is in this range, right? So independently verified with a different study, I came up with 1.5 with my non-calculus math. That was pretty close here. So I'm calling it like this. It's probably not exactly what it is, but it's pretty close, that this upper left is direct sunlight and then cloudy diffuse light and then twilight and darkness. So that was some context for the study that helped make some sense to me. And then I looked at the one log reduction thing and drew some lines down, and you could see in direct sunlight, we're looking at 8 minutes to get a one log reduction. That's pretty good, right? And similar, maybe 10 minutes in a cloudy day, and then maybe 12 minutes at twilight. So it doesn't take a lot of UVB to get this one log reduction in viral load. So exposure to sunlight is a significant thing. There's science to back that up. So this situation has a lot of COVID risk, but not because of surface transmission. I think that this is out in the sun. There's a lot of kids all over it in general, unless you're coming into contact with the surface right after a kid that sneezed on it. The surface transmission is probably not your biggest risk here. It's probably the large droplet transmission from proximity and not wearing masks. But what's interesting to me is that if there's no kids on the playground, I'd feel pretty comfortable having my kids play on that, right? If I want to be really sure, I might wait 10 minutes and make sure no kids played on it. And I'd count on the sunlight to really reduce that risk. I think that's something I could feel okay about. Perfect about it, probably not, but okay about it, I would say yes. Another thing is, I don't think personally that science says you need to try and wipe down this table. I think if this table's been outside for a long time, it's probably okay, right? Your surface risk is probably very low. Again, am I a scientist? Am I telling you there's zero chance? No. But what I'm telling you is that most of the risk is mitigated by UVB exposure if something is sitting outdoors in any amount of sunlight. All right, so we talked about different wavelengths. UVC light will even more rapidly inactivate the virus, specifically studied at 254 nanometers. Even at very high viral loads, it has a pretty significant impact on reducing active virus. So again, a study that's difficult to read, right? But you're all getting good at this. So the first thing you looked at was, wow, 10 to the seventh, that's a lot of virus, right? They started with a very high concentration of virus. It actually matches the concentration from the lungs of a terminal COVID patient. So I'm not trying to be dramatic there, but I'm saying that's a very high concentration, typically found in phlegm from lungs of somebody with a bad case of COVID, a severe case of COVID. Even so, you can look at that and draw conclusions. You can say a one log reduction takes 2 minutes. You get 90% inactivation of 2 minutes combined UVA, UVC in this test. I would make the argument that you could discount UVA. If you look at these charts at the bottom, it took a lot of UVA to get a one log exposure and very little UVC. So let's look at that. Those are total concentrations, 60 millijoules per centimeter squared dose for one log reduction of UVC, 360 for one log reduction using UVA. So the point of this study was that UVC has a significant impact, around a 90% reduction at 2 minutes. Later on in the second section, when we talk more about UV, I'll get into how the distance really affects the intensity. This was done at a very close distance. So you can't just say because I output intensity X, that intensity stays constant. It drops off with distance pretty rapidly. But total exposure, if you can get 60 millijoules per centimeter squared, that should give you a one log reduction. So this is an important study that we can use in surface and airborne inactivation down the road. So key to understand here. So I'm not the only one who knows that. If you look at any lighting manufacturer page, they're all coming out with different UV lights, UV inactivation products. Pay attention to the wavelengths. Most of the studies focus on 254 wavelengths as, or wavelength, 254 nanometer wavelength as the most effective range. If you get to the edge, there's things called near UV or far UV. Those aren't as effective. So you need to find studies on the wavelength that you're looking at. And when I say they're not as effective, that's on this virus. So near UV does a pretty good job with bacteria if you give it enough time. So in hospitals, they may have something that isn't UV, but is close. And over time, that will lower the risk of bacterial infection being spread by surfaces, but it's not that effective at viruses. So that's something to pay attention to. The other thing I will say is these products do work. Pay attention to the distance, and you can't expose people to UVC light in a safe way. So they have to be shielded from occupants. So some of these things that are near UVC will say it's safe for human exposure, true, but things that are 254 nanometer wavelength are not. So again, these can't just be used blanket any distance, and they can't just be applied blanket any occupancy. Some of these you do have to be really aware of keeping people shielded from them. All right, so examples in the built environment. This is a tricky one, elevator buttons. So there are touchless elevator buttons. They're not common. And if you get in an elevator, it's kind of not worth it if you're not going to touch the buttons. You need to push those to get where you're going most of the time. So I think this is a good application of surface cleaning. That'll take care of it if you have somebody in there cleaning it. Or UV. I think that if you could do UV when it was unoccupied, that would also take care of the issue. Or obviously a touchless elevator panel would solve that. But the point here is that lots of people touch it at a high frequency. And there is a risk with elevator buttons of surface transmission, especially because you don't know when the last person was in there or what they did. They may have sneezed right on the buttons, right? Restroom fixtures, way easier to mitigate, but there is an issue there. You can go through most public buildings without touching anything until you get to the restroom. especially as my wife pointed out, if you're a woman, you touch the stall door. It's kind of hard to make a doorless stall that's effective. So this is an area to pay attention to. It's an area that needs to be cleaned. I would argue clean it yourself. This is an area you could wipe down, or specifically when you come to fixtures, you can install touchless fixtures and it does remove that touch point. It would break that cause chain, right, to get this touch out of there. So that is a high touch environment in most buildings. Shopping carts. We all have to continue to go shopping. These are something that most retailers, most grocery stores have honed in on as an area that needs to be cleaned. I think they've all rightly landed on the fact that segregating these, cleaning them with bleach or alcohol, and then putting them back for use is pretty good. That works. Initially, when this all started back in March or April, we were talking about, do we need cart houses with UV lights and constant sanitization? And while I think that would work, I don't think it's necessary. I think wiping these down with those cleaning agents is backed by science. And if you give it at least a minute of contact time, that does work. So personally, when I go in, I wipe them down and hold on to the wipe for a minute or so and give them my wipe down time to work. But I think that's a manageable risk there. Another thing, security screening. That's a touch point that the industry is trying to figure out now. How do you minimize security screening when you have to take things in and out of your pockets? You have to touch common bins. That's a tricky one that the industry is still working to solve in venues and specifically in public transportation. I don't have the answer to that yet. It's probably technology that's the answer. You know, it's different forms of scans, different bins that are made of material that don't let the virus survive as long. But I don't know that one yet. That's a tricky area. All right, so we talked about this path up here on the top, the surface transmission path. Digging into that a little bit, I think that claim I made earlier about how maybe this one's overstated is probably valid. And I think maybe overstated is the wrong word, but it's at least the easiest one to mitigate. And so it becomes the lowest risk transmission vector as long as the mitigation efforts are in place. If we quit worrying about that, then if we quit worrying about mitigating surface transmission, I think it might become a high risk vector, but we're pretty good at managing it, and it's intuitive to not touch things, you know, to reduce your touch points, or to have things be outside, or to wipe them down, or to just wait. Just time can reduce this. So in an office setting, I think generally, for the most part, every day is a new day, right? The surfaces in a building tend to have viral load reduced just through time. Most importantly, though, I think masks are pretty effective at stopping those big droplets like we talked about. They're 90% plus. If you can get people to wear masks consistently, it really will cut down on the viral load on surfaces, which makes it less necessary to do all these other things. So I think it's valid. I think that viruses are readily transmitted through surface contact, through this fomite path, but I also think it's the easiest one to manage. All right, so Amanda has told me we may have questions out of order again. So I'm gonna look at these as we go through it, but we are at the end of this section. So we'll take another break and I'll ask some more questions and we'll all buckle up and see if we know the answer to them or not. Hey, so these look like questions that you should all know. So it is 10:04. What I'm gonna do is come back at a little bit after 10:10. And we're going to pick up with the next section, the aerosol section, which has a little more depth to it than these other two. It will take slightly longer, but not significantly longer. So thank you for your attention. I'll be back a little after 10:10. right. I think there's a question from Randall that Angela was going to take, I think, assuming she's back on yet. So we'll see if she picks that up here.
Hi, Destin. I was just going to answer on the chat.
Oh, okay. I will say that, yeah, that is, it's a valid question, right? He said, using the word eliminate to me means total elimination. I think so too. I think I would answer that question as no, it doesn't totally eliminate it. All right. So we're doing pretty well here. It's 10, 11. This section, I think, again, should take 25 to 30 minutes-ish, leaving us some time for questions at the end. Yeah, so I'll just get started. Talking about airborne transmission path, we covered droplets and surface. This is airborne. So if we looked at this cause map, it's the bottom. And the cause chain here is a little bit different. You have to have infectable virus suspended within the breathing zone, which means a couple of things. This one has an or in it. They're not all ands. It means somebody has to expel that particle within the breathing zone. And it has to either float by you on the way back to the return or be recirculated from another zone. So the floating requires a couple of things. It has to be light enough to float, and you have to have turbulent airflow within the space. If you go again to the right, turbulent airflow in the space is something that we as designers can work on. So that's the reason you see clean rooms or operating rooms have laminar airflow, one directional airflow. That's not easy to do, but it's approachable in a commercial space using some technologies we'll talk about in a subsequent presentation. So just thinking about this from the cause map, if you look at it and you think intuitively, okay, virus has to be there and it has to float by a person on the way to somewhere else. That's the very simple version, right? So now we're gonna dig into the science behind that and say, well, is that possible? And I do think that this cause map got sent to people. I also think it's probably hard to read on the screen, depending on the size of your screen. I'm at home so much, I got this massive monitor, I can see it, but that's probably not common. On a laptop, it'd be hard. If you wanted to, I've also posted this to LinkedIn. If you connect with me on LinkedIn, you can download a copy of this document. All right, science behind it. So there's a study where somebody said, well, is airborne transmission even possible here with SARS-CoV-2? There's been controversy around this. Initially, the guidance came out based on the assumption that it wasn't airborne. Over time, scientists published studies and made calls to action for the World Health Organization and CDC to say this is airborne and we need to be worrying about that and mitigating it as an airborne virus. So the argument was it is more similar to measles or TB than it is to a common cold, which is not very transmissible through the air. So we're going to look at that evidence and dive in here. So I kind of restated this as a logic test for aerosol transmission. You need to prove that your saliva or phlegm contains viable virus. You need to prove that breathing, talking, singing, coughing generates airborne particles of sufficiently small size to aerosolize. You need to prove that it remains viable in an airborne particle. And then the last one, you can't prove that breathing in airborne particles can cause infection. There is gathering circumstantial evidence there, but it's always a case study in reverse, because again, not ethical to infect somebody and say, well, how much airborne virus does it take to infect someone? So what you'll find if you look for number four are studies to say in this restaurant in China, somebody sitting 18 feet away that never had close contact and never touched anything that this person touched still got sick. Therefore, we think airborne transfer is possible. So there's a lot of circumstantial evidence gathering around four. But all I can do in this presentation is look into the science for one, two, and three. So let's do that. Saliva and or respiratory fluids contain viable virus. So there's a study. I thought this was a really interesting study that we're going to take some time to unpack here. Looking at phlegm and nasal swabs and stool for concentrations of virus over time. And you can see that respiratory fluids, phlegm, this orange bar, are where the highest concentrations are. So kind of fix that in your head that particles, actually stool might be the highest concentration, but it's not what we're talking about in this section. So fix in your mind that particles that come from the lungs, either coughing or like singing from your diaphragm or things that come from your lungs, tend to draw higher concentration, higher viral load than just talking or nasal or sinus fluids, but they all do contain virus. So this was interesting, I thought. It gave you measured concentrations of virus over time, and you can see it varies with person and it varies with time. So days after onset of symptoms is the x-axis, concentration of RNA is the y-axis. If you go get a COVID test, they will tell you concentration. You have this concentration of viral load in your nasal swab. So it would come in an RNA per milliliter log number. Anyway, point of this, there is a sufficient concentration in phlegm or in saliva to have a measurable amount of virus. This one was fascinating to me. Breathing, talking, singing, coughing all generate airborne particles of sufficiently small size to aerosolize. So there's a lot of math behind this one. So we're not talking about big droplets, right? Like I watched Hamilton during the shutdown with my family, like most of America on Disney Plus. And I love King George, great character. That guy had a lot of large droplet transmission while he was singing. Those are really large droplets. So when we're talking about singing, it also aerosolizes a lot of particles. This next study will show this. It aerosolizes a lot of particles from your lung. They say, you know, sing from your chest, not from your nose. Those particles are coming out in pretty sufficient quantity. So if you look at this, this is a particle size breakdown and number of emitted particles per second. Again, with that backlighting laser light study and then high-speed photography, they measured number of particles per second. This was an Aerosol Science and Technology Journal article. This has been referenced a lot, but there's a sufficient amount of particles that come out when you're doing pretty normal things. And they increase with the amount of force that it takes to do the thing. So loud talking, it expels more particles than normal talking or breathing, right? Intuitive, but there is scientific evidence to back that up. So this becomes a thing when you're talking about aerosol transmission. If you remember that chart, that risk chart, the activity matters. So if you're sitting silently and just breathing next to somebody, that's different than if you're loud talking or singing next to a person. So think, you know, high school volleyball game in a poorly ventilated gymnasium where everybody's shouting. That's a lot different than a lecture in that same auditorium where everybody's just sitting there quietly. And singing does tend to expel the most particles. So I went down this rabbit hole of, well, if we're expelling particles, what makes them aerosolize? And I was pretty excited to tell my kids that there's math behind this. So I found this study that looked at Stokes' law, right? We probably, if you're an engineer, you remember that from college physics, but it's a way to calculate the terminal velocity of a falling droplet, and it scales as the square of the diameter. So the smaller the droplet, the less terminal velocity you can generate, the less mass you have, the less weight you have to fall. And once airborne, speech-generated droplets rapidly dehydrate. If you've seen a lot of the good science out there around the effect of humidity on airborne transfer, that's why a particle can go from 50 microns to 10 to 1 based on humidity and the ability of the dry air to draw the humidity out of the particle, making it smaller and lighter and easier to aerosolize. So that's why science says humidity affects airborne transfer. It affects its ability to aerosolize and move around freely on the air. So I just thought I'd take one more dive down this, but if you think about a 10 micron particle, a pretty big particle, falls at about 0.7 feet per minute. So typical room current might be 20 feet per minute, but it's at a right angle or an up angle or a down angle. It varies a lot, right? Like that sideways current would push the particle to the side as it falls, because you remember force vectors and X and Y motion are independent from each other. That moves to the side as it falls. But if that air current is slightly up, which happens all the time, air currents swirl about in a room a lot, it might push the particle up, right? So you have force vectors, X and Y, 3.5 feet per minute pushes up more than 0.7 feet per minute pushes down. So you might get the slight upward motion of the particle. And that happens all the time. And the smaller the particle, the less upward force it takes to float it. And so you can imagine a room with all these different air currents and all these different particles. The really small light ones will float and transfer around on air currents and make their way 20, 30, 50 feet down the road there into the ductwork, even potentially, and getting recirculated. So particles can aerosolize, I believe, based on just force vectors and math. So there was a question around the right humidity range to reduce risk. I don't have that in this section. I might not even have that actually in the overall presentation. What I've seen shows that the lowest risk is between 40 to 60% humidity that keeps the particles from aerosolizing by keeping them as large as possible and causing them to drop out. So they would transfer from an airborne risk to a surface risk, which we've shown is easier to mitigate. So hopefully that answered that question. All right. So does a virus remain viable in an airborne particle? There turns out, same study that looked at surfaces also looked at aerosols. And this one was really eye-opening to me, that it's about 3 hours for a one log reduction in airborne virus. So they would sample the air and then put it in a petri dish and regrow it and look for regrowth. And after about 3 hours, there was significant reduction in the viability of the virus in the air. That's something you can deal with as a building owner or an engineer, is, well, let's design around this. Not saying it's 100% gone at 3 hours, but that, again, every day is a new day in a building, right? Overnight, you could count on a lot of the virus dying off. Before I would tell somebody for sure, I'd want to see a lot more studies on this, but that's been a pretty consistent thing that gets said, is that it can survive for more than 3 hours in the air, but it'll always get followed up with this thing of a half-life of 1.1 hours. So it dies off pretty quickly in aerosols. And I think that's important. And I think the impact of temperature and humidity on that is significant and was held constant in this study. And that's something that requires further research. But I think that's something that as engineers, we ought to start to get our heads around, is that there's a time component to risk mitigation too. It's not a forever thing, because you can start to layer strategies on top of strategies and get to where you're reducing an infinitely small amount of risk with some pretty expensive strategies. And we'll get to that in the next session when we talk about mitigating airborne risk. But to me, the foundational thing is just understanding it. And then for your particular space, you can apply these mitigation strategies in a way that make the most sense. So to me, when I'm talking with clients, I talk about near-term risk as more significant than long-term airborne risk. So here's what I would say. I would amend that statement we had before. And I would say there is a risk of shared space and recirculated air, aerosol transmission of COVID-19. That 6-foot distance rule should be treated as a guideline. I treat that as a guideline. So I find it frustrating when rules will say we'll wear masks unless social distancing can be maintained. Like, to me, that doesn't make sense scientifically. I think you ought to say we will wear masks and maintain social distance when possible, right? Like, you'd flip that. But I would say this claim is keeping 6 feet away from an infected person will reduce but not eliminate the risk of large droplet contact. but it'll do very little to minimize aerosol particle contact. And I'll show you what I mean there. So I've put this picture up a lot. The next part of that study, so this looked at large droplets, and they said large droplets fall out generally 2 to 3 feet, but the small droplets go 7 to 8 meters. So if we go back to this manual of physical distancing picture, you can see that cloud. MIT said that's a 23 to 27 foot distance that some of those can travel. That depends on the humidity, depends on the air currents, depends on lots of things. But that's a real thing. Like aerosol transmission of this can happen. And as we get into the math, the mathematical modeling later, we'll show you what we mean there. But I do think aerosol risk is a significant one, potentially the most significant. All right, so I talked before about shared space and recirculated risk. As engineers, I think it's good to split these two in your head and think of them differently, because the solutions for each one are different and solutions to one don't necessarily help the other. So if you imagine yourself in this building, you and your friend, and your friend has COVID and is shedding particles, those particles go across you on their way to the return. That's a shared space risk. So strategies to remove the virus from the recirculated air don't help you in that case. So if you're in a shared office, classroom, small space, you have that shared space risk of particles floating on the air on their way back to the return that's really difficult to mitigate. But you would have, I would argue, a smaller risk in a related space due to recirculated air. So what percentage of that virus makes its way through the duct without impinging on it all the way back to the air handler without impinging on anything? I don't know, but it's arguably some that gets recirculated into other space. And it's totally dependent on the length of duct, the design of the system, all these things. But it's highly possible that you could have a recirculated risk in a building. Depends on your initial concentration and the specifics of that system. But I think it's good to think about it as shared space risk and recirculated risk, because you apply strategies differently depending on those two. So we talked before about masks and large droplets. I think it's important to talk about masks as an aerosol mitigation strategy too. My argument after reading these is that they're 50 to 60% effective on small aerosol particles and 100% effective on large droplets. So that's a little too nuanced for the general public. People want a yes or no answer. I would say masks work really well because they're 100% effective at large droplets and 50 to 60 on small. So if we go back to this study, remember our key study on the effectiveness of mask materials, and we put this chart next to it that shows particle size in microns from normal activities, talking and singing. And then we look at that next to this graphic about the effectiveness of different materials, paying attention to the fact that one is in nanometers and one is in micrometers. So we put this green bar so you can tell the difference, because again, virologists and epidemiologists write this for other virologists and epidemiologists, not for the rest of us. So those scales being different does make it difficult. But if you look at this, you've got really effective, highly effective results from cotton masks that fit effectively. So this, again, cotton batting, don't make a mask out of stuffing you took out of a pillow, not a good idea. These other materials that they were testing to see if they had electrostatic attraction on really small particles don't work as well for these small droplets. And I would argue that these ultra fine particles are not as common and not as possible, right? Like particles tend to aggregate together to form larger particles in the air. So if you're trying to use a mask as a self-protection measure, I don't think you're going to come across a lot of super, super fine particles in the real world. I think they tend to aggregate together. So most of the particles are going to be in this range, this green shaded range here, around 1 micron plus or minus. And masks are pretty effective at that. Just a basic cotton mask works pretty well at that. All right, so examples in the built environment. These are tricky. Education, small space, long time, recirculated air with lots of people, that's the risky area for airborne transmission. So the CDC revised their guidance for significant exposure to say 15 minutes of exposure in any increment, 15 minute total exposure over the day. Education absolutely does that, right? And you're not in a big room and you're active doing lots of things, shedding particles. This is going to be an interesting study when we look at our mathematical model and probabilities to say, well, what is the risk? Putting aside the significance of contraction, I know there are arguments around whether it is as high of an impact on kids, but just in terms of transmission, this is a risky setup. You've got a lot of people in a small space for a long time. This is another one I see a lot, workplace meeting areas. So this is one where I see the 6 foot rule applied in a way that doesn't make logical sense to me. So these people, for the most part, are reasonably far apart. This was obviously taken before COVID. Nobody has any masks on. Nobody takes a picture without a mask on anymore, but they're reasonably far apart, but there's a lot of airborne risk here. There's a relatively small space. People tend to spend significant amount of time in there, and they usually pull their mask down when they talk so they can be heard, and they talk loud so they can be heard. And oftentimes they'll eat in this space, which means they take their masks off and they'll talk while they're eating. So there's an unknown risk there, a shared space risk as that floats around and makes its way back to the air handler. These are the trickiest of all. So dining areas, obviously you're not going to wear a mask while you eat. That's just not a feasible ask of the general public. The areas I'm seeing that are the trickiest are not only restaurants, but are dining areas in non-dining buildings. So like a food court in a mall or a dining area in a venue. These tend to be problems because people congregate there. They're eating, so they take their mask down. And they're talking loud because it's loud. It's in a loud venue. The real trick is when you can buy something here that you take back with you to your other seat in a venue, that can cause even more issues. That can make that large droplet transmission more of a risk because people buy popcorn or candy or whatever and take that back to their seat and they don't wear their mask because they're still eating. They've carried that item with them back to their seat. So dining combined with anything really does complicate risk mitigation. It's a tricky thing. And again, don't have the solution to it. I've talked to lots of professional sports leagues and they're all struggling with how do you manage this, you know, the popcorn issue or the hot dog issue. I don't know how to manage that yet. All right. So quiz time. I think we're going to go through the last round of questions and then we'll reconvene. I'll do a super brief recap, one or two slide recap, and then we'll have some time for questions. So hopefully now we've covered all this material, all these questions have been covered, not intended to be overly tricky. So I'll go back through the answers when I come back. It's 10:34. I will come back around 10:40-ish and we'll reconvene, go through a recap and then do some Q&A.
I'm a little sad that I can't take this survey as a panelist.
I'm sad for that too, Justin. No, I think you would have nailed it.
It's just, you know, it's fun. You get to click bubble.
Hi, everyone. I'm Amanda Giles. I've been working with Dustin on developing some of this content, pulling stuff together. I apologize for the question issues as we've been going through things today. When we rearranged content, I forgot to go in and update the question order, so that's completely on me. I apologize. Real quick, though, I would like to go through all 10 questions. Like I had mentioned in the chat, we are going to be sending out a link to a survey that has all of these questions in it. So if you weren't able to access the Zoom polling for any reason, or if you were answering questions just based on a random guess before we had addressed the issue, you can go through and answer those questions again in the survey. But real quick, I'm going to go ahead and go through what those 10 questions were. Let me pull up my list here. So the first was, in what ways is COVID-19 spread? The options were fomite or surface, large droplet, aerosols, or all of the above. Clearly, that is all of the above based on the conversation we've been having today. Second question, does keeping a 6-foot social distance from others completely eliminate your risk of large droplets? The answer to that is no. As Dustin was just going through, that social distance does not keep you completely immune from catching up on that. The third question, is the importance of social distancing the same for all situations? No. Just like Dustin was talking about, if you have a quiet situation where you're outdoors, it's going to be a lot lower risk than if you're screaming at each other in a gym. Are cloth masks considered to be an effective mitigation tactic against large droplet transmission? The answer to that is yes, as long as it is well-fitting and worn properly. How much of a reduction does a 1 log reduction represent? The answer to that is 90%. So as you have a 1 log reduction, 90% of it is gone. Which bands of UV have been proven to inactivate SARS-CoV-2? The options we talked about were UVA, UVB, UVC, A and B, B and C, or all of the above. And the answer is UVB and UVC are the ones that have the most study on them on inactivating that, that virus. Approximately how long can SARS-CoV-2 survive in the air? I've actually altered this question a little bit because we had a little feedback that it was a little bit confusing. What we talked about was the fact that it could survive for a 90% reduction would be about 3 hours is what we were getting at here. So I've altered that question a little bit to make it a little bit more straightforward for you. Which activity generates the most aerosol particles? Breathing, normal talking, loud singing, or sleeping? Just like Dustin talked about, it's going to be your loud singing that projecting from your lungs, you're going to be producing more particles. And then last but not least, what activity represents the greatest risk of transmitting COVID-19? Shouting in a gym, singing an outdoor concert, listening quietly to a sermon in church, or talking outdoors with 3 friends, it's going to be that shared space and the loud speaking, the shouting in a crowded gymnasium. And then the last question, small aerosol particles can travel up to how far according to an MIT study? And Dustin, I don't have that answer marked on my list for some reason. Would you like to chime in and answer that, and then we can wrap things up?
Yeah, the MIT study said 27 to 30 feet. So 27 feet. All right, turning my camera back on. 1 second. All right. Thank you, Amanda. I'm sure that was helpful to everybody. These, like I said, we're not trying to trick anybody with those. All right. So back to the recap. Briefly, we talked about this, the 3 transmission methods. This chart is the recap. So hopefully you got this sent to you. If not, it's available on LinkedIn. But surface transmission, droplet transmission, and airborne transmission. Think about them in those 3 vectors. We went through all 3 of those. And then I think the important takeaways from this, I tried to just say, if I had 2 minutes to tell you this information, I would say there are those 3 transmission paths. Masks are very effective at large droplets, pretty effective both incoming and outgoing at smaller droplets. So it does protect the wearer. When I send my son to school, he has a mask with another layer of filter fabric inside of it. And I feel like that does offer him some protection as a wearer, not only to the other occupants. Sunlight rapidly inactivates coronavirus. So does UVC light. Aerosol transmission is possible. And the virus that causes COVID stays viable in the air for roughly 3 hours. And obviously lingers beyond that, but most of the risk is mitigated in 3 hours. All right, so I would like to answer questions if you have them. I'm tired of speaking. I'm sure you're tired of listening to me. So questions will be welcome here. If not, we will wrap up a little bit early based on the amount of questions you have.
Hi, Dustin. We have a question about the research on effectiveness, if mm-hmm. any, on masks protecting the wearer as opposed to excelling mitigation. Yeah.
I think it's both. It depends on the fit. The test was on the fabric and it wasn't one directional, right? So you get protection in and out. It's just that if you wear a mask that doesn't fit well, airborne particles can make its way around the side because that's path of least resistance on air. So that's why those N95 masks, you know, fit like they're welded to your face. It's to cut down on that leakage. So I've worn those and they do work and they do fit tightly. The closest you can approximate that with a cloth mask, the more risk mitigation you have. And then, like I said, with my son, I put another layer of stuff in there when he goes to school, just because I do think that helps him out.
There was another question. May we share your presentation? And I know that Amanda is going to be uploading the recording live, the live recording to your YouTube channel, mm-hmm. Henderson Energy Engineers YouTube channel. So.
Yeah. Any other questions that are coming through or comments from other people? We had Justin and Aaron on here. They'll be helping with the subsequent presentations. I don't know if they had any comments. Doesn't look like it.
Wow. Hey, super dark right now. Sorry. I just wanted to affirm what you said about the cloth masks question. There are many people among the scientific community who are using the calculations that estimate risk, and they are applying cloth masks and any kind of mask both to the exhaled particles and the inhaled particles. So just like anything else, they have a filter efficiency with them and they have the bypass factor with the air going around the mask if it's not fitting tightly. But if you increase your efficiency to the highest level, if you prevent any kind of recirculation, then that cloth mask on your face will do a extremely good job of filtering out airborne particles. And if it's not tight fitting, it just does a okay job of filtering out particles. So in all cases, it does help.
Thanks. All right, I'm not seeing any other questions come through. So Angela, I don't know if you're ready to wrap this up or if there's other things you needed to say, but.
Yes, I do. So in closing, I hope you've gained greater insight into how infectious particles are transmitted. And I would like to thank you for attending today's webinar. I truly appreciate Dustin for sharing his knowledge and expertise of the research on this project, on this topic. I will be sending out a feedback evaluation later today for you to complete and submit. I would really appreciate your completing that as it's part of our grant reporting. Within a week, you'll receive a link to the recording in a certificate of professional development hours. Please join us for the next two webinars in this series, Understanding the Science Behind Mitigating the Transmission of COVID-19. November 12th from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. will be Mitigating the Risk of COVID-19 Airborne Transmission. So we're going into the science behind the airborne transmission. And November 19th, 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. Central, Modeling the Effectiveness of Risk Mitigation Strategies. It's a really great where they're applying the mathematical models towards how effective we can mitigate the risk. So I really appreciate the science that's been put behind this. The format will be the same as today. As for those who could not access the polling questions or did not see the polling questions, one thing that we've done in the past is asked that our attendees make sure you're on the latest version of Zoom. I know I had 3 updates just in the last week to my Zoom. So just make sure you're on the latest version of Zoom. And in the meantime, any comments or feedback you would like to share directly, can be emailed to energy_education@arkansasaee.org. With that, Dustin, thank you so much.
I almost made it through, but thank you. I was talking while muted. Thank you. I appreciated it. I appreciate the time.
You do have one more question. Mm-hmm. Do the layers of PM 2.5 layers that come with masks help stop the transmission?
Yeah, I'll be honest. I don't know. PM 2.5 is a particle size measurement. I'd have to look at that to give you a detailed answer. I don't want to just answer it off what I think.
I do agree with you on the Etsy mask is getting mm-hmm. great reviews.
Yeah, I probably sold some masks for them.
I know. The 600 threads per inch with the chiffon lining on the internal side.
So I have to look at the PM 2.5 thing specifically. I would say it arguably doesn't hurt, right? Like any mask is going to filter some amount, but the specific answer to that on percentages, I don't know off the top of my head.
All right. No more questions. Justin, thank you so much. Amanda, thank you so much for facilitating this for us today.
Yeah, you're awesome, Amanda.
Yes, she is.
Have a good day, everyone.
All right, everybody, have a great day. Bye. Thanks.